happy Easter. Yeah, he is risen. Yeah, let's try that again. You're supposed to respond with, he's risen indeed. He is risen. Amen. Let's stand together. If you have a seat next to you in the middle, won't you move to the middle? We're going to have quite a few people coming in now and then not finding seats. And this song is praise. We're going to clap. We're going to make a noise. We're going to shout. This is the day that Jesus rose for us.
One, two.
Praise in the valley and praise on the mountain. I praise when I'm sure and praise when I'm doubting. My praise when I'm numbered and praise when surrounded. Kids, you can come to the floor. You can get a space for the people.
Every
amen. He is risen. He's risen indeed. Good thing we gave you a practice run just now. One more time, if we can ask that there is a seat to make some space on the aisles. If you don't mind just moving in, that would be super, super helpful. But there are more chairs coming in right now. So good to be all together today on Easter Sunday. Yeah. Yes, the day that we celebrate the risen King. The fact that Jesus died, but that he rose from the grave. And death and sin have been conquered. Isn't that just something so beautiful to sit in, right? We can just sit here in the knowledge that he has conquered it all and that he is alive, and we have the privilege of being able to know him and have a relationship with the living Jesus Christ. So I'm so glad that you're here today. If you're joining us online, a super, super special welcome to you as well. I pray that you are munching on some Easter eggs right now. That's what I hope for you. And the rest of us, won't you stick around after the service? We've got hot cross buns to share as we just kind of spend some time chatting together and getting to know one another. If you have never met me, my name is Debbie. I'm one of the pastors here, and it's always a great privilege to be with you. We've got a few opportunities coming up in the life of our church to get plugged in for certain things that might help in your own spiritual journey. If you're a young adult, I'm not going to give an age bracket. If you consider yourself to be a young adult, and if you look in the mirror and the mirror still tells you you are, just going to put that out there, because sometimes the mirror and how we feel is a little bit different, right? And we've got a young adult alpha course starting up. This coming, if you have questions and you're a young adult, or if you know people who have questions, won't you invite them to come? For that, it is a great opportunity together. We need a little bit of help in families. And three courses that are going to be running concurrently: parenting. So perhaps you or you know somebody who has lost a loved one, or perhaps has been going through a divorce, or is about to go through a divorce, or is a single parent. These are three amazing opportunities just to get a little bit of support and to get a bit of input for your own journey and where you're at the moment, and just to gather with some like-minded people who are going through the same thing as you are. And so if that is you, or if you would like to invite someone, you need to sign up for those courses so that we know who's coming up at that start, which is the 9th of April. And then thirdly, we are starting a new series here at church next, so not this Sunday coming up, so as in, not next week, the next week. And it's called Fueled. It looks a little bit like this. And pretty much, it is looking into the topic of holistic renewal for our lives. What does spiritual renewal look like? What does mental renewal look like? Emotional, physical. What does that look like? How can we really love the Lord our God with all our heart and soul and mind and spirit? Going to be a six-week course that we'll be preaching around here in the services, and we've got these beautiful manuals that will follow what we're preaching into your personal daily devotions. And so if you would like to get one of these books, they cost 20 rand. They're available today and next week at the information desk. You can purchase one. They're really great books for 20 bucks. I'm very, very impressed myself. But really, really awesome stuff. And so perhaps you want to buy for yourself, and you can pick that up so that you're ready for the course. Or even if you would like to pay an extra 20 rand and buy a book for somebody else, you might not know that person, or you can give it straight to them. And we're going to also be running this series at our Pinetown campus. And so, yeah, it's going to be really, really great. So Fueled will be starting in 2 weeks' time. So those are five really, really great opportunities just to get plugged in to the life of our church in some way. We're going to take a moment to take up the offering. I just wanted to read you a verse from scripture this morning. It was just after the people had come and brought their offerings to rebuild the temple. And what a beautiful thing. It said, the people rejoiced over the offerings, for they had given freely and wholeheartedly to the Lord. I think sometimes I forget that it is such a privilege to be able to give to God. And on a day like today, a weekend like this, we remember so much that He has given, that I can come and rejoice over my offerings as I give them freely and wholeheartedly to the Lord. And so let's do that as the stewards come and take up the offering.
Anybody here ready to give God glory tonight? Did anybody come ready to testify of the Lord's goodness? Satan fall like lightning. I saw darkness run for cover. But the miracle that I just can't get over, my name is registered in heaven. I believe in signs and wonders. I have resurrection power.
together, sons and daughters, bought with blood and washed in water. Sing the praises of the Spirit, Son and Father. Our God will finish what He started. Yes, our God will finish what He started. Oh, this is my testimony from death to life. 'Cause grace rewrote my story. I'll testify while Jesus Christ the righteous. I'll justify. This is my testimony.
He is risen. He is risen indeed. Today, billions of Christians in millions of churches are declaring boldly that Jesus is alive. They have so much confidence. It's such good news. But is it too good to be true? Thomas, one of Jesus' closest friends, thought the same thing. He was there when Jesus was crucified, dead, and buried. That Sunday morning, Jesus was working and moving, and everyone saw him. But Thomas missed out. Discouraged by everything he hadn't seen, Jesus was going to set the captives free. But the Romans captured Jesus. They crucified him and Thomas's hope, but the Romans captured Jesus. They crucified him and Thomas's hope died with him. Even once he was surrounded by people declaring, just like today, "He is alive, we've seen the Lord." It wasn't enough. His faith was literally blind because he hadn't seen what God had done. But God never asks for blind faith. A few days later, Jesus was standing among them. Then he said to Thomas, "Put your finger here and look at my hands. Don't be faithless any longer. Believe." Jesus gave Thomas the overwhelming evidence he'd asked for. Then Thomas declared about Jesus, "My Lord and my God." And Jesus told him, "You believe because you have seen me. Blessed are those who believe without seeing me."
Salvation, one doorway that leads to life, one redemption, one confession. I believe in the name of Jesus Christ. I believe in the crucifixion, by His blood I have been set free. I believe in the resurrection. His life is to God the Father. All praise to Christ, who was and is and evermore will be. In Jesus' mighty name, of heaven, He's preparing a place for me, far beyond what hearts imagine, ears have heard or eyes have seen. I believe that a day is coming, He's returning.
of the gospel of Jesus Christ. How could I ever walk away from the one who saved my life? No, I'll never be ashamed of the gospel of Jesus Christ. How could I ever walk away from the one who saved my life? And no, I'll never be ashamed of the gospel of Jesus Christ. How could I ever walk away from the one who saved my life?
All praise!
All praise to God the Father. All praise to Christ the Son. All praise to the Holy Spirit. Our God has overcome. The King who was and is and evermore will be. In Jesus' mighty name I believe. All praise to God the Father. All praise to Christ the Son. All praise to the Holy Spirit. I was buried beneath my shame, and who could carry that kind of weight? It was my tomb till I made it, and I was breathing but alive. And all my failures I tried to hide. It was my tomb till I made. You called my name and I ran out that grave. Needed rescue.
My sin was heavy, but chains break at the weight of your glory. I needed shelter, I was an orphan. Now you call me a citizen of heaven.
When I was broken, you were my healing. Now your love is the air that I'm breathing. I have a future, my eyes are open. Cause when you call my name, I ran out of that way.
Pray together. God, it's so good to celebrate you and just make a big noise, really. Our vocals, our lyrics, our music, our clapping, just to give you, the King of Kings, some worship and some praise this morning for what you did for us on that cross. Thank you, God, for dying for me. Thank you, God, for dying for each and every one of us here. What an amazing blessing and privilege to know you, Jesus, the King of Kings, the risen Lord. We are in awe of you, Jesus.
Great the chasm that lay between us, how high the mountain I could not climb. In desperation I turned to heaven and spoke your name into the night. Then through the dark, your loving kindness tore through the shadow of my soul. The work is finished, the end is written. Jesus Christ, my living hope. Who could imagine so great a mercy? What heart could fathom such boundless grace? The God of angels stepped down from glory to wear my sin and bear my shame. The cross has spoken, I am forgiven. The King of Kings calls me his own. Beautiful Savior, I'm yours forever. Jesus Christ, my living Lord.
Hallelujah.
The death that loves. the morning that sealed the promise, your buried body began to breathe. Out of the silence, the roaring lion declared, the grave has no claim on me.
Then came
the morning that sealed the promise. Your very body began to break. Out of the silence, the roaring lion, Jesus, yours is the victory. Hallelujah.
Welcome. It's just, they got over 40. They got over 40 units, which is amazing. Yeah. Egg Hunt, thank you for being here on Friday. And Cindy, thank you for telling us on Friday how much Jesus loves us. This incredible love that is actually for everybody who sees it. That he loves me, he loves me not. He loves me, what's even better? In this desperate, last way, he didn't sacrifice himself and then free. Really, of life? I mean, if you saw an empty grave, what would you think? Minds. Isn't really proof of life. It's like a cross. It's proof of a lot of things, but just on its own, the truth is just that face value. Because the truth is, Eve done saw, told them what was going to happen. None of the tool. Confusing. You can see. Quotes it. Now remember I said that these people knew they lived in a house that they had been raised by Jesus from the dead. Okay. Mother of James and Salome brought spices so that they might go to and anoint Jesus' body. Very early on the first day of the entrance of the tomb. But when they looked up, they saw that the stone, very large, had been, and they were alarmed. Don't be alarmed, he said. You are looking for Jesus the Nazarene who was crucified. He has risen. He is not here. Go, tell the disciples and Peter, he is going ahead of you into Galilee. There you will see him just as he told you. Trembling and bewildered, the woman went out and fled from the tomb. And they said nothing to anyone because they were afraid. Guys, don't worry. That's not the end. Okay? If you read the others, they do eventually start saying stuff. I promise you they do. But do you see the confusion? Can you see that actually believing in a resurrection is a hard thing? Even for people who had physically witnessed a resurrection. You know what it is, don't you? It's too good to be true. It's too good to be true. And so there's just this confusion. But what? And then Jesus steps back into the picture. How tempted he must have been to go. I mean, what do I actually have to do, people? What do I have to do? Seriously, what do I have to say? But you see, he loves us. And so he doesn't. He doesn't go, oh, really? In fact, he does exactly the opposite. His tomb is there, it's empty, and now he goes around proving his life. He steps out of that empty tomb and he begins to go to these people who, and instead of going to scold them, he proves life to them. Go and does almost no feed people and those things. He did that before his death. What he does is he has conversations with people. And he talks to them. He reminds them of things that had happened. And he sits with them on the beach and he talks. And he just tells them their story and his story. He shares food with people. He sits down and has a fish bra with his disciples. He says, "Here, here's food. Eat. Let's have a meal together. Something you're going to do after this. Let's eat and talk." Sometimes he proves his life through awkward moments. Imagine how awkward Thomas was. You know that awkward moment when somebody's been in hospital and they want to show you their scar. Oh, look. But you see, even that's not beyond Jesus. He says, "Thomas, I know you're struggling, my friend. But come look. Come look. It's real." What he does is he proves his life in real relationships with real people. In ordinary, everyday settings, meals, journeys along the road, hiding, running away. You see, he loves them. He loves them in the ordinary, everyday. Of course, he does miraculous things. He does some amazing things for them. But the only reason he's doing it is he wants to show them again and again and again how faithful he is, how patient he is, how eternal and forever and powerful and for always and for everybody his death and his resurrection is. Jesus gives every one of his disciples who saw that empty tomb proof of life. Yes, it's me. Yes, I'm real. Yes, I've risen from the dead. And yes, I love you. Him is proof of life. But you see, what's beautiful for us this morning, what we can celebrate this morning, is that that proof of life wasn't just for them. Those early disciples who saw and encountered Jesus remember that he'd said to them, "Now listen, once I go, you've got to get out there and tell the story to other people." This proof of life doesn't just stop with me. Cindy referred to a passage from 1 John on Friday. Now remember, John is the disciple who refers to himself as the disciple Jesus loved. He could just never get over the fact that Jesus loved him. And that's how he refers to himself. And all his writings are just again and again. Now listen, 1 John 4. "This is how God showed his love among us." Don't you love that? Among us. Us rebellious, stupid, hard-headed, annoying, self-centered disciples. Us. "This is how he showed his love among us. He sent his one and only son into the world that we might live through him." You see the idea that this love, this life of Jesus, this resurrection, it doesn't end just because Jesus went to heaven. It's now in us. "This is love. Not that we loved God, but that he loved us and sent his son as an atoning sacrifice for our sins. Dear friends, since God so loved us, we ought to love one another. No one has ever seen God. But if we love one another, God lives in us, and his love is made complete in us. This is how we know that we live in him and he in us. He has given us his Spirit, and we have seen and testified that the Father has sent his Son to be the Savior of the world. If anyone acknowledges that Jesus is the Son of God, God lives in them and they in God. And so we know and rely on the love God has for us. You see, these disciples realize something. That empty tomb isn't just proof of the life's life. It's proof of our life as well. This is how we know. We have this love. We've started loving the kind of people that moved his life in us. We used to want to hang out with those kind of people, but now we do. Because our lives are transformed. They were with Jesus. Went from being fishermen for people, and they were able to have arguments with, to step out of jail when they were in prison. Their lives had been transformed, discovered. He's real in our life. In love, not just and themselves. You see, they discovered as they began to live that life is now in us. And it can only have come from wide, and in a sense, keeps getting better. Guess what's even better of life? Of life, says it in that passage. Now we know, and because we know, things start to happen. All of a sudden, we are living in ways we didn't understand before. All of a sudden, we are reaching out to people we didn't know before, didn't love before, because his Spirit has been given to us, and we can testify that Jesus really is the Savior of the world. Here's our job. As we look at that empty tomb, as we look at that cross, and know that he loves us, and know that we have proof of both love and life, here is our job: to prove his life in us. And you know how we do that, don't you? The same way he did. You see, the temptation is, well, now I have to do all sorts of spectacular stuff. Now I have to become this really unusual and holy person. I have to become a miracle worker. No, I don't. I just have to take this life of Jesus and go out there and have conversations, just like he did. Go and talk to people in their everyday lives, wherever they are. Talk to them. And when the opportunity comes, tell them why you are the way you are. Why you are different. Why you believe that that empty tomb honestly is proof of life. Share food with people. Invite them to meals. You never know what happens over a meal. I know some of you felt sorry for me having to go down and up and down on Easter Friday. I'm not lying, my cards are sore. It's worth it. I want to tell you why it's worth it. Because you get to look into people's eyes, and you get to see what they say, and you get to talk. And on Friday, there's a little girl just over here. She's probably 10 or 11 years old. And as I shared that food with her, that meal, as I said to her, this cup tells the story of the blood of Jesus, which was shed for my sin and for yours. And she looked at me and she went, yay! Do you see what a meal can do? Do you see what just having food with somebody else in the name of Jesus and just a conversation? The proof of his life is even in those awkward moments. That moment where you have to apologize to a friend because you said something. That moment that you actually would rather avoid. But where you ask for forgiveness and they say, why? You say, well, because Jesus. Perhaps that awkward moment when you confront somebody because they're doing something they shouldn't be doing. But you see, this proof of his life in us is in real relationships that we have with him, with the Spirit, and with one another. It's found in love. It's found in his love for us. And because we are able to love him, love our neighbor as much as we love us, that's where it's found. And that Jesus is real. That his love. You and I will take those seeds. That's why we have a packet of seeds on your chair. Those of you who didn't have to sit on a chair that was carried in. They're just ordinary African daisy seeds. Next week, the next month, the next year. That the proof of love and the proof of life of Jesus Christ is in every single one of us, and we can give it away. We can spread it around. And it's going to happen just as we live our lives. Why? Because it's not about us or our strength. It's about a Savior who did not consider equality with God something to be grasped, but emptied himself, came into the world, lived and died and rose again for the salvation of the world. Let's pray together. Oh God, thank you for this gift of this proof of life. Lord, thank you that today we can celebrate he is risen. He is risen indeed, and he has proved to us that he lives, and he lives in us. Father God, won't you give us as a church family the strength to go out there and scatter those seeds, to have those conversations, to eat those meals, to have those awkward moments, to pursue real deep relationships centered in the love of God that he has for us so that we can have it for others. Oh Lord, as people look at our lives and see behind us the cross and the tomb, may they know that those two things are not empty symbols or things that Christians just think about at Easter, but that those two symbols are proof of love and of life. I want you to keep your eyes closed for a moment. And I just want to invite you. Perhaps you have never grasped that gift. Perhaps as you sit here, you go, I've actually never grasped that gift that God offers to me. His salvation and his love.